For our next online lesson, we're going to take a look at two of the neurotransmitters noted in the textbook. Now, certainly there are many more neurotransmitters and neuromodulators and hormones and other chemicals that you need to learn about in the psychopharmacology chapter, but we're going to focus on these two today. The first one is acetylcholine. We will also look at dopamine in just a minute. Acetylcholine, or ACH for short, is the primary neurotransmitter used by efferent neurons of the peripheral nervous system. That simply means neurons that are going out of the central nervous system out to the body. In this case, we're talking about motor neurons. So if you talk about the neuromuscular junction, where neurons innervate the muscles, all this muscular movement is going to utilize ACH, or acetylcholine. Inside the central nervous system, ACH is important for learning and memory, and therefore we see a lot of projections in the hippocampus. This is a neurotransmitter that we see influenced by diseases like Alzheimer's disease, which we'll talk about later in the textbook. This is a diagram from your textbook, which is looking at a rat's brain. And here we see a mid-sagittal section that is looking at the different projections for acetylcholine throughout the brain. As you can see, it's located in a number of locations, but we see projections going to the lateral hypothalamus and the amygdala, and also to the neocortex. And also, if you go back into the brainstem, we see it projecting from the locus coeruleus into the substantia nigra and into the hindbrain. So the acetylcholine is found throughout the brain. Acetylcholine is made up of acetate and choline and is synthesized via the enzyme choline acetylate transferase, or CHAT for short. Here we see acetyl-coenzyme A and choline go together, and we use a choline acetyl transferase. We then create CoA and ACH. ACH is then deactivated by acetylcholine esterase, which is an enzyme that breaks down ACH into its component parts. So this also provides another mechanism for drug action. Not only can we influence the drug through the production of acetylcholine or through acetylcholine transferase, but we can also interrupt or interfere with acetylcholinesterase and therefore modulate or change the function of acetylcholine through various drugs. There are two types of acetylcholinergic receptors: nicotinic, which is an ionotropic receptor, or muscarinic, which is a metabotropic receptor. Ionotropic receptors are faster. Metabotropic receptors are slower because they are coupled to a G protein. So this again gives us two different mechanisms through which to activate or affect acetylcholine's impact on the nervous system. Whenever we talk about neurotransmitters, students are always interested in what sort of drugs or toxins work through those neurotransmitters. So drugs or toxins that affect the release of ACH include botulinum toxin, which is found in some foods that have spoiled. And it prevents the release of acetylcholine, so the muscles can't contract. As you also might be aware of Botox, that's the whole point of how that works, because the message is not getting sent. So my message in my brain says to furrow my brow because I'm frustrated with my students in biopsychology class. However, the message doesn't get sent because the acetylcholine isn't released, and so it doesn't talk to the muscle, so the muscle doesn't contract and my forehead stays nice and smooth. Now, on small doses, it just blocks those tiny muscles, but certainly if you were to ingest botulinum toxin from a spoiled food, it could cause your heart and your other muscles to not contract, and therefore you couldn't breathe or your heart wouldn't beat, and that would be pretty serious in terms of a life-threatening situation. Another drug is curare, and this is going to work through those nicotinic acetylcholinergic receptors. It's also going to lead to paralysis, but it's actually going to work even faster than the botulinum toxin. Next, we're going to take a brief look at dopamine, or DA for short. Dopamine is from the monoamine family of neurotransmitters in the subclass of the catecholamines. The system of dopaminergic neurons runs again throughout the brain, but there's three major systems that I want you to be familiar with. One is the nigrostriatal, which is going to include the substantia nigra, which is going to be important for movement. The mesolimbic system is going to project to parts of the limbic system, which we've talked about in previous lessons. which includes the nucleus accumbens, the amygdala, the hippocampus, and these include the reward centers. That's what the nucleus accumbens is. That's what's going to light up when we have sex, when we eat chocolate, when we do drugs, and therefore it's a site of reinforcement, so it's important for learning, but it also can be a site for drug action in terms of addiction and drugs of abuse and other substances that can become abused. The last one is the mesocortical projection, and this is going to project to the prefrontal cortex for planning, problem solving, and short-term memory. So this is kind of tying all the things together. We've got our kind of basic systems of the amygdala and the reward centers, but then again, we still have that prefrontal cortex, which does get to make some decisions and make some planning. And so it might not be just as simple as having your part of your brain that wants what it wants when it wants it. The front part of your brain can actually say, hey, let's wait a minute. This figure right here, again, illustrates what we've just talked about. It has the nigrostriatal pathway, again, with motor control, the mesolimbic and mesocortical pathways. It also has the tuberoinfundibular pathway, which you don't necessarily need to know for this class, but again, highlights the fact that dopamine is projecting throughout the brain and has a number of roles in the nervous system. Certainly, when many of you think about the central nervous system and the role of dopamine, you're thinking about Parkinson's disease, because when that neurotransmitter system gets disrupted, Parkinson's disease can occur. This occurs when there is a decrease in the number of dopaminergic neurons, usually because of death, or there's not enough synthesis of dopamine from the L-DOPA. And so we get tremors and rigidity, damage and death to those neurons that are in the substantia nigra, which makes sense because they're the ones that are tied to movement. And that's what we see here in this scan. Is in a healthy brain, the red and the yellow is lighting up in areas of the basal ganglia and the substantia nigra, and in Parkinson's disease, that activity is greatly reduced. While there are lots of drugs that work through the dopaminergic system, and we'll investigate a number of those later in the term, we're going to just look at a few here. AMPT is going to interfere with the synthesis of L-DOPA, and so we're not going to be able to synthesize or make dopamine or other drugs in that class. Reserpin interferes with the storage of monoamines in synaptic vesicles. So again, here's another mechanism of drug action. Not every drug works on receptors. This one works through those synaptic vesicles. So if their vesicles become leaky or can't store the neurotransmitter, then the neurotransmitter can't be released effectively. Cocaine, which is a drug we'll talk about in more detail later in the term, actually blocks dopamine reuptake. And so the dopamine can't be recycled, so it stays out in the cleft longer, as we can see by the diagram below, and has more opportunities to activate the receiving neuron. The same mechanism of action occurs with methylphenidate, which is the name of Ritalin, as many of you know, which is used to treat ADD and ADHD. And it's basically the same mechanism. It's going to work to block the reuptake of dopamine, allowing those dopaminergic neurons to stay in the cleft longer and activate the neurons. Methylphenidate is a much slower acting drug than cocaine, and it's a much longer lasting drug than cocaine. So while the mechanism is the same, the effects aren't identical. It's also important to note when we talk about the effects of neurotransmitters and drugs is to remember that there are many different receptor types. Sometimes we sort of focus entirely on the neurotransmitter as if it's the most important thing. And in fact, there are many different receptor subtypes that are in different locations and are responsive to different agonists and antagonists and have different effects because of their location and number throughout the brain. So just keep that in mind as you think about how neurotransmitters work and how drugs often work through the same systems.